Here's a factoid for you. According to the United Nations, Africa possesses 30% of the essential minerals needed for renewable technologies and enjoys no less than 60% of our planet's best sunlight exposure. In July 2025, the UN Secretary General, Antonio Guterres, said this.
By 2040, Africa could generate 10 times more electricity than it needs entirely from renewables.
That's quite a claim, isn't it? And surely an opportunity for any enterprising capitalist entrepreneur looking for a potentially lucrative gap in the market somewhere. And it turns out, somewhat ironically, that the most enterprising capitalist entrepreneur operating on that vast continent in recent years has been China. To paraphrase the International Monetary Fund, there was a vacuum, and China has been far quicker than Western nations to exploit that vacuum in the renewables and infrastructure space. The 12 months to June 2025 saw a 60% increase in solar panel imports into Africa, and now folks in off-grid areas are generating their own power for less than half the cost of a diesel generator. And if you're wondering why that is in the slightest bit relevant to you, then stick around, because the answer might surprise you. Hello, and welcome to Just Ever Think. So is that it then? China just swoops in and scoops up Africa like some kind of token on a geopolitical board game? Well, not quite, but it's easy to see why that metaphor might seem compelling. For decades, most Western nations treated African development like a bit of a side quest, a dribble of aid money here, a few development projects there, but very little real investment in the sort of hard infrastructure that actually powers modern economies. By contrast, China offered the construction of roads and ports and railways, as well as really great energy deals, not as charity, but as mutually beneficial commerce, at least on the face of it anyway. Because while there's no doubt those investments have resulted in visible progress in many African nations, they also raise some tough questions about debt and dependency and who really calls the shots when the loans come due. We'll come to that a bit later on. But first of all, let's get an idea of the size and scope of the African renewable opportunity, courtesy of yet another brilliant piece of analysis from the internationally respected think tank, EMBER. This latest report highlights a real surge in solar across pretty much the entire continent. 20 countries set new records for solar panel imports in the 12 months to June 2025, with Algeria, for example, experiencing a 33-fold increase in that single year, taking it into third place as the largest cumulative African solar importer behind South Africa and Egypt. And you can see the shape of the curves on all the country charts, can't you? They look an awful lot like those disruptive technology S-curves that we've looked at so many times in previous videos on the channel. If we look at that on the map, then we can see that almost every single African country had some level of solar panel trade with China during the past year or so. The range is extremely wide, of course, from a very modest 2 megawatts in the Central African Republic, all the way up to almost 4 gigawatts in South Africa. But the point is, China is there, in every nation, exerting its considerable influence and offering very attractive partnerships to national governments, not to mention individual solar panels that are so cheap that almost anyone, even in the remotest off-grid areas, can get hold of one and put it on the roof of their home, usually to provide a bit of light during the evenings instead of relying on the traditional kerosene lamps that are so harmful to human health and so impactful on the climate. In a country like Sierra Leone, enough solar panels have been imported since 2024 to provide more than 60% of all that nation's electricity demand. And the continent really is just at the foothills of what looks like becoming an exponential growth curve, certainly if Pakistan's very recent experience is anything to go by. In the same 12 months to June 2025, Pakistan imported more Chinese solar panels than the entire continent of Africa, despite having only 1/6 of the population. An astonishing achievement that displaced no less than 38% of that country's diesel consumption. That staggering level of growth looks highly likely to be replicated in Africa during the second half of this decade. Research by Wood Mackenzie found that in 2022, 17 African nations actually had more diesel generator capacity than utility grid power plant capacity. And when you set the cost of solar against the current price of diesel, you find that a solar panel in Africa can pay for itself in just a few months. You can get hold of an imported Chinese 420-watt solar panel in Africa nowadays for about $60. On average, that panel will produce 550 kilowatt hours of energy per year. By contrast, $60 worth of diesel bought in a typical African nation today would get you about 275 kilowatt hours of electricity. That means a solar panel is essentially breaking even after only about 6 months and effectively providing free energy for at least the next 20 years or so. And in many African nations, diesel prices are far higher than the average, so solar panel payback time is even shorter. Those numbers are difficult to ignore, and it's not just the basic cost of replacing diesel that's so attractive, it's the opportunity for economic growth and stability it gives to individuals and local communities. The size of the prize is enormous. But the path to get there is anything but straightforward. The EMBER report reminds us that oil imports into most African nations still completely eclipse solar imports right now, representing anything from 30 to 107 times the volume in US dollar terms, depending on the country in question. That is a massive mountain to climb, and perhaps one of the main reasons why Western nations have been so complacent in recent decades. But as we've seen, the overwhelmingly advantageous economics of solar photovoltaic power generation on the sunniest continent on Earth are now becoming inescapably obvious, especially at the level of individual homes and local microgrids, where the real revolution is taking place. Nigeria, for example, which just happens to be Africa's largest oil-producing nation, beat Egypt last year for solar imports, making it the second largest importer on the continent in the last 12 months. That country has notoriously awful infrastructure, combined with the usual rampant bureaucratic corruption, as well as a pretty bad problem with vandalism on oil and gas supply lines. According to this recent article in the Financial Times, Nigerians have also suffered the removal of a state subsidy that was making it cheaper to run the diesel generators that help get urban homes through regular grid power outages and provide energy for the 85 million Nigerians who have no access to the national grid at all. Practically anyone who can afford it has solar panels on their roof right now in Nigeria, according to Mohamed Wakil from the Global Energy Alliance for People and Planet, an organisation heavily involved in the rollout. And while more affluent people are getting their own home systems installed, even the poorer folks in off-grid areas are able to benefit from those communal microgrids, bypassing the need for a main grid connection completely. And here's why it matters to all of us, and not just to Africans. According to a 2022 report by the United Nations, more than half of the projected increase in the global population up to 2050 will be concentrated in 8 countries, 5 of which are in Africa. A separate study by the Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation suggests Nigeria itself is growing so quickly that it could overtake China to become the second most populous nation on Earth by the end of the century. If that population rise is fueled by oil and gas, then the prospects for our global civilization, including those of us in apparently comfortable Western nations, will be extremely grim indeed. But if Africa does manage to leapfrog those old technologies and move directly to renewables, firmed up with things like battery energy storage, to drive economic growth and bring about the desperately needed reductions in poverty, hunger, and water scarcity in many of those nations, then it would represent arguably one of the greatest achievements in human history. And of course, a massive opportunity for investors. Which brings us nicely back to that bastion of capitalist entrepreneurial enterprise, China. I am, of course, being a little bit facetious here, but there's no doubt that China is a long way ahead of the West in terms of investment in African infrastructure. Recent analysis by the think tank Chatham House shows that during the first 2 decades of this century, Chinese financing filled real gaps in African infrastructure, not just in power projects, but in roads and ports, and even in the digital services sector, at a scale most Western lenders rarely matched. But legacy Chinese loan contracts often used to contain clauses that obliged the borrowing government to pay the Chinese lender back first, whatever the circumstances might have been with that country's economy and finances. Collateral typically had to be kept in a dedicated bank account, often in a Chinese bank, with China having control or visibility over it, so that if the borrower did run into trouble, China could take what it was owed directly from that account. Nowadays, Chinese lenders are apparently a lot more considered and collaborative in the way they structure loans, according to research carried out for this 2021 Atlantic article in conjunction with the Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies. Horror stories of Chinese asset seizures and land grabs in response to debt defaults are broadly unsubstantiated, despite often being touted by Western nations to depict China as some kind of ruthless, marauding imperialist nation. The research showed that Chinese banks are actually now quite willing to restructure the terms of existing loans and have never actually seized an asset from any country. But China now faces economic headwinds of its own, doesn't it? According to this very recent analysis, Chinese investment in Africa is slowing down as companies retrench to fight fires back in the motherland. Sadly, in our current rather inward-looking nationalistic geopolitical environment, it seems unlikely that any Western nations are going to be sprinting to fill that new void, which means overall economic growth might also slow a little in Africa in the coming years. But what is much less likely to decelerate is the eye-watering production volumes of Chinese solar panel manufacturers and their drive to find new international markets to sell those panels into at ever-decreasing prices. So even if a few large national infrastructure projects do get put on hold across the African continent, the revolution in small-scale distributed microgrids and rooftop solar energy systems looks set to carry on regardless. And that could turn out to be hugely beneficial to all of us. I'm quite sure there are plenty more statistics and variables and parameters that are at play here that I haven't included in this short summary video. And no doubt you've got your own news and views on the subject of the global energy transition too. So as always, it'd be great to hear your thoughts down there in the comment section below. That's it for this week though. If you like these sorts of videos, then the best way to give me your stamp of approval is to hit the like and subscribe buttons if you haven't already done so. It's just a simple click, but it makes a massive difference to the channel's growth. So if you feel I've earned that click this week, then you would be a very kind person indeed. You can also directly support my work by joining the fabulous group of individuals over at patreon.com/justhaveathink who keep the channel running and enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of your way. Most important of all though, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.